Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. This time on the program, it's music icon and L.A. legend, Ice Cube.
Freaking brothers every way like MJ. I can't believe today was a good day.
O'Shea Jackson, Ice Cube, is a music icon, one of the founding fathers of gangsta rap. He's a giant at the box office as an actor and as a producer.
We said we was changing the game, and we did.
And now the basketball league he founded, Big Three, is entering season four. I can't believe it. Ice Cube is here. Welcome, Cube. It's great to have you on the program.
What's up, Frank? How you doing, man?
It's great to have you.
Man, it's great to be here.
What a life you are leading. When you were a young guy coming up, did you think you would have all this? Music icon, movie star, movie producer, and now founder of a major basketball league?
Not at all. You know, it's been a great life, of course. Great, you know, to do music and then to be recognized, you know, on a national, on an international level. But then to recognize the opportunities that that brings and to, you know, seize the moment.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And recognize those opportunities and, you know, challenge myself. And you know, after so many years in the business, here I am. You look back and it's a lot of cool things that's happened throughout my career. But, you know, it's something that I never dreamed of.
Yeah. I want to talk in depth about Big Three, but before we get there, I just want to ask you about the music and about this big life you're leading. In fact, I want to talk about this award that you've been named for, the 2020 Game Changer Award from the UCLA Anderson School of Management. Jay Tucker, who's the executive director of the Center for Management and of Enterprise and Media Entertainment and Sports, said this about you. He launched his career as a teenager telling stories about his neighborhood and his community in a genre of music that was still in its infancy. Today, he's widely recognized as a pioneer in music, a Hollywood icon, and a game-changing entrepreneur in the world of basketball. It is a big award to be recognized in this way by UCLA.
Yes.
And I was asking you a minute ago, your father, who's still with us.
Yes.
Was a groundskeeper at UCLA.
Yes.
When you told him, Dad, they're honoring me, was that some like a completing of a circle? What was that like?
Yeah, I mean, you know, he worked there. A few of my family members worked at UCLA. My mom even worked there for a minute, for years. And, you know, to be able to first of all, I want to, you know, I'm truly honored by UCLA for this award. I mean, it's something that you never think about when you're just, you know, doing your day-to-day thing, and to be recognized by, you know, such a prestigious university is, you know, something that I cherish and, you know, definitely will always think about and remember. And, you know, the fact that my parents did, you know, work at UCLA, and, you know, I remember them, you know, going to work, coming home, cheering for UCLA and the Rose Bowls and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, it's cool to go back there and take them with me. But this time, you know, the party's for us. And you know, they're not, you know, helping out up there. We're going near the party. So
yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Congratulations on
yes.
that. It's a wonderful thing. Sitting here with you, you are so down to earth. And your wife is here, she's down to earth, and you guys are so approachable. You've been kind to everybody here.
Mm-hmm.
And it at times I think, is this the same guy in the music videos? Is this the guy who, you know, you seem so hard in some of the music. And mm-hmm. is that, I don't want to say it's an act, but it's a different phase of your life, or how would you describe it?
No, it's all me. You know, this is all part of me, who I am. You know, there's no reason to be hard right now, is it? You got to recognize your blessings, too. And I've recognized my blessings. You know, I want to be an example of, you know, starting in one place and, you know, you never know where you can end up. You know, I don't want people to be able to judge a book by its cover, so to speak. So, all of these are part of my personality, my music, my movies. I love sports.
Yeah.
You know, I do a lot of comedies. I love to laugh, you know, but I do recognize, you know, it's a time to laugh and it's a time to cry, so to speak. And so my music, you know, I choose to speak on some of the ills and some of the things that face us in society that may not be so cute. We talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Yeah.
And that's what I love about the music.
Yeah, that young guy who's singing in N.W.A. And a lot of the music is about themes that, as you said, you don't want people judged by their cover.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of it is about police brutality.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think as you've gotten older, things have gotten better or worse? Or do you see it differently now at this station in your life as an older man?
Well, you know, abuse is abuse. No matter when it happened, you know, 1989, 1989, 2009, it's still something that we have to deal with, something we have to look at, something we have to stomp out.
Mm-hmm.
It is a cancer within the department. You know, they got some guys that's, you know, real bullies, and we want to get those guys out of the force. I think it'll be a better place for the community. And, you know, I think the department will get a lot more respect from the community if they lay off the abuse. So I'm going to always speak on that. I don't know if we're going to stomp it out in my lifetime. But, you know, I'm going to point out when anybody, you know, things that I see that need to be changed, you know, every pencil needs to be sharpened. So sometimes they need to sharpen their pencil.
Even in just speaking right here, you speak with this poetry, and I wonder where that comes from. Is it something that was innate? Did you read a lot of poetry when you were, you know what I mean? I mean, where did that come from? This ability to write and spin words in the way that you do.
God-given. You know, in school, I was always able to take my thoughts and put them on paper and be able to, you know, speak how I feel. It's come natural. You know, thank God I got into, you know, music, especially rap music, when you can really what you feel.
You sold your first song at 16, right?
Yeah, 16 years old.
To Eazy-E.
Yep. I wrote it for a group called HBO, who Eazy-E was managing. It was a group out of New York, and they didn't understand what I was talking about, you know, when it comes to six folds and, you know, all the L.A., you know, lingo.
Right.
So they rejected the song, and Dre convinced Eazy to do it, and the rest is history.
Yeah, indeed. As I said, we want to talk about Big Three basketball, big changes on the way for Big Three basketball this season. We're going to talk about those changes and Ice Cube's close friendship with Kobe Bryant when we come back.
Oh man, I love you, Kobe, just for being yourself. You know, your spirit is in all of us, man, and we're going to continue to have that same mentality.
Thank you for building up so many of us to have a mentality to be our best. And wherever you are, shoot.
Oh, Ice Cube with his son, O'Shea Jackson Jr., Kenny Smith tribute for TNT for Kobe Bryant. That was really, I thought, such a beautifully done piece.
Amazing. You know, something like this, you know, sometimes bring out the best in us. So Kenny Smith thinking of that piece and putting it together, and, you know, some things you have to be a part of.
Yeah.
And, you know, we all honoring Kobe in our own way, shape and form. And, you know, I want to do it as much as I can because he meant that much to me, you know, just as a fan and a friend.
Yeah. You texted him after you heard about the helicopter crash.
Yeah.
Did you know that he was gone?
I was hoping he wasn't. You hear a lot of stuff. You know, I've heard stuff on myself. You know, people text me, "You okay?" And I'm like, you know, yeah, I'm good. So I was hoping to get, you know, one of those messages. You know,
yeah.
I'm good. You know, they just, but it wasn't a B. And you know, it's just a sad time for everybody in LA, everybody in the world, really.
Yeah. What are we gonna miss not having him here in LA?
That's the thing. That's what makes us all sad. We know that, you know, he had more greatness ahead of him. He was a young man, so we knew he was going to give us something special in the future, and we're not going to get that. And, you know, this is what we cry over, not being able to, you know, see, touch, hear, experience Kobe Bryant. In the future.
Yeah. You tried to get him after his NBA career to play Big Three. Tell me about
every
that.
Day, every year. You know, it's like Kobe inspired the league. Me and my partner, Jeff Quinn, you know, my wife will tell you, we've been thinking about this league probably since 2015. And it was just, you know, I want to do it. I don't know. Think this will work, you know, we, of course, contemplating whether this is a great idea. And, you know, Kobe scored 60 points in his last game. I'm calling, this is it. We doing it, because I can't see Kobe play no more.
Right.
And in our league, we can see him play again. And so that was the jump off.
Wow.
That was the, you know, the, like, let's burn the ships, let's go for it.
Burn the ships. And when you would say to him, come on, Kobe, here's a chance for you to play, what would he say?
He'd smile and he'd say, not in a million years. And then I start thinking about it. You know, he gave us 20 years of basketball at the highest level.
Yeah.
You know, if the dude don't want to play at that level no more, you know, I'm going to let him relax. I'm going to leave him alone.
Right.
He won't need a restraining order. But it was a hope and a dream that one day he would, you know, say, you know what, I got the itch.
Yeah.
You know, I'm 57, but I got the itch, and I'm ready to play a league. You know, so it's something that, you know, we're going to always honor the Mamba in our way in the Big Three as well.
A lot of guys do want to play, though.
Yes.
And you've got great talent in the league. And it has been amazing. Did it surprise you when you started reaching out to guys and saying, come on?
Well, you know, what surprised me was guys who was like, I don't know if this is going to work. So, but there was more guys that was like, oh, yeah, you know, send me more information on it. Let me know what you're doing. You know, let me call you and let's talk about it. They wanted to see if I was a true basketball man.
Right.
If I was a true, you know, was I just a, you know, entrepreneur looking for a good opportunity, or did I love basketball? Did I love them as the, you know, the Hall of Famers and the stars of the game that they are, and would I treat them with love and respect? And the answer is yes.
Yeah. Well, I was saying to you, it seems like every time I'm at Staples Center, I see you there to root on a team. I mean, basketball is part of who you are. You love basketball.
Love basketball. You know, grew up playing it, you know, here and there. High school coach fronted on me, so I couldn't play it in high school. But you know, I loved it. Fan, for sure. Laker fan to the max. And to be a part of a league where, you know, I get a chance to rub elbows with Dr. J, Michael Cooper, you know, Reggie Theus,
right.
Iceman, George Gervin, Rick Barry, you know, these are our coaches, and it's cool to be able to be part of these, you know, these legends of the game, and to you know, to move forward with the future of the game.
Yeah. Well, and to that point, let's take a short break. We know you got changes coming to the league.
Yes.
We're going to talk about those changes. They're exciting changes. Back with Ice Cube in just a sec.
Big Three is not your grandfather's three-on-three. It's its own sport, more exciting than anything that's come before.
This is over, David, triple the way.
Fast, physical, professional. As a matter of fact, it's more advanced than anything you ever seen.
And we're talking to one of the founders of the Big Three Basketball, Ice Cube. When you started this thing, mm-hmm. people said to you, what?
Cube. It's not going to work. There's already an NBA. There's no room for another professional basketball league. And I was like, I don't believe that's true. You know, us playing in the summer where it's very dead, you know, it's even the dog days of baseball in the summer.
Right.
So we knew we had a window. We knew we had a sport that was already there, you know. Half-court basketball has been played forever. So just let's just elevate it to the professional level and show people that, you know, we got the biggest party in town in the summer. And it's been a blast.
Yeah, well, starting season four now.
Yes.
And so you've proven the critics wrong. And I just wonder, when people are your critics and when they do say no to you, how do you handle that?
You know, we use it as fuel. We don't take no for an answer. We feel like there's always a better way. If they're telling you no, they're talking to you. So that's, you know, you might can get a yes out of them. You keep talking long enough. So, you know, long as they're talking, you keep talking. And some people told us no year one, told us yes year two. Some people told us no year two and told us yes year three.
Yeah.
So, you know, we plan to be here 100 years. So we plan to turn all the naysayers into fans of the Big Three.
Yeah. When did you know this is working? I mean, it's one thing to launch the league and to have a game or two going. When did you know we are doing it?
Seeing the fans jump up out their seat and cheer with every winning shot. You know, we have no shot clock.
Right.
I know they're bragging about that in the All-Star game they just played. But we started that, and we have winning shots on every game, and it's exciting. And we knew you get that kind of reaction with these players, it's a no-brainer. Once you watch a Big Three game or come to a Big Three game, you're hooked.
Yeah. And we've all come to the games thinking, okay, I'm going to see my favorite former NBA player. Mm-hmm. But now you're opening it up. You're opening it up to young guys.
Yes.
Letting guys try out.
Yes.
What are you seeing in terms of the talent that's coming in?
Oh, great. You know, we have a lot of people signing up. But now we started off at 30. We went down to 27 last year. We're going down to 22. We're having open tryouts May 15th through 17th out here in L.A. And you do your thing in a tryout, you can get invited to the combine. You might can get drafted, and you might can make a squad. So to me, it's exciting to see the new influx of talent that's going to come into the Big Three this year.
I mean, there are so many guys out there who play basketball who didn't get to go up through the college system.
Yes.
Or go straight to the pros, who have great talent. If you just go to any of the local gyms, you can see it.
Yes, I mean, and, you know, we don't think it's going to be a lot of guys that can play at this level, but right. There will be a few. And we want to see those guys. We want to see those guys make it. And, you know, we feel like, you know, some guys might not be NBA players, but they might be great Fireball 3 players.
Right.
Some guys might be, great Fireball 3 players, not great NBA players, or great NBA players, not great Fireball 3 players. It's a whole different sport. So it takes a whole different set of skills to succeed in it. So.
And you're calling it Fireball 3.
We call it Fireball 3. It's still the Big 3. Big 3 is who we are. Fireball 3 is what we play. We just got sick of saying we're professional 3-on-3 because 3-on-3 gives you a picture in your mind, and it's an amateur sport. Mm-hmm. So we're Fireball 3, which, you know, you got boxing, you got the UFC, you got the NBA. Yeah, you got Fireball 3.
Any other big changes coming to the league this year that fans will want to know about?
Oh, the Bring the Fire rule, which is a rule that allows players to challenge a foul once a half and go one-on-one.
Right.
So it's going to be cool. It's like, it's what every, you know, people have been dreaming for an in-game one-on-one situation, and we're going to bring it to you this summer.
The older guys, when you say 22-year-olds are trying out, is that fair to a guy who's at the end of his career having to play against a young 22, 23?
I thought about that until I saw all these YouTube clips of our guys running in the gym with 22-year-olds anyway, staying in shape. So I'm like, you guys are playing with the youngsters anyway. So right. Basketball is one of those things where, you know, especially in the half-court setting, these guys will be great, no problem.
Right. Speaking of ageless, I sort of see you as ageless. You don't age physically, first of all, and then your talent continues to thrive at another station in your life. What are we going to be talking about 5 years from now? What is Ice Cube working on?
Well, you know, hopefully my league will be, you know, just part of the fabric of American sports, and I'll be doing something cool. Might run a network. You never know.
Run a network?
You never know.
Come on. You can't tease me like that. Is that something that you're in talks to do, or is it something you're thinking about? Or
I'll see you in 5 years. We'll do that interview. You know, my philosophy is this. If you didn't know how old you were, would you know how old you are?
Ah, it's a good question.
Live like that.
All right. Well, Cube, thank you so much. This has really been a tremendous conversation. I really appreciated you coming in to talk to us. As I said, we're going to continue the conversation on the audio podcast. I want to say to our viewers at home right now, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.